actually a really important and a wonderful community that has been here around here for a long time. So this is one of those new places, I think, that makes something like that possible. Getting started all around where they have to become part of this community. My presentation today draws on century put into play and the global intellectual history of philosophy. The project is at its early stages, but today I'll walk you through one episode and how put into play is done. So first, let me just say a few words about him and who he is. Put into play was born in 1105 in Muslim Spain, and he died in part of what today is called Andalusian philosophy. Ibn Tufayl was part of this so-called Golden Age, though he wasn't actually read as much during his own lifetime. We only have one complete text by him, Hayy ibn Yaqdhan. Hayy ibn Yaqdhan is a philosophical allegory. The literal translation of the title is Living Son of Awakened. That's also the name of the protagonist. So let me just offer a brief overview of the story. And I should say, it's a very odd story, but I think that the weirdness should be preserved. So, the text. These images, by the way, are from a children's picture book from the 1980s. The text was turned into a children's story. It begins with a survey of philosophical opinions about revelation and God, and then an allegory about Hayy ibn Yaqdhan and two other characters named Absal and Salaman. Ibn Tufayl says that Hayy ibn Yaqdhan was either spontaneously generated on an island, or he was left in an ark by his mother and eventually drifted to this island. In either case, he ends up on an uninhabited island where a doe finds him and raises him. Some of the other animals start to bully him, so he learns to use sticks to keep them away. Some 8 years later, the doe dies. Hayy dissects her, quite naturally, in order to save her. While poking around her heart, Hayy realizes that her soul has departed. Perhaps we could say his trauma led him to invent the soul. Hayy figures out that there is a god, and eventually he becomes able to behold him. He worships him, and by the time Hayy is 50 years old, he now understands everything about existence. The story could have ended there, but it does not. Ibn Tufayl says, meanwhile, on a nearby uninhabited island, or on a nearby inhabited island, an esotericist named Absal leaves in search of seclusion. He is shipwrecked on Hayy's island. Absal teaches Hayy language, and Hayy imparts philosophical wisdom to Absal. They find that Absal's religion is actually a lesser image of the truth that Hayy had discovered on his own. So the two visit Absal's island in order to educate the inhabitants. While there, the people flock to Hayy, but he thinks that they misuse the tools of logic, as he's incessantly preaching at them. Their initial awe towards Hayy turns into bitterness. But they try to stay polite because Hayy is a guest, and he's friends with their friend, Absal. When Hayy realizes that this is what's happening, he becomes convinced that most people are at the level of irrational animals. You can't teach them, you can't save them, and that's why they have religious laws to govern them. He was wrong to try to help them. So he tells the islanders, listen up, you guys were right, forget everything I said, you keep doing what you were doing. And he returns to his island with Absal, where the two work together until they die. So a very odd story. But to many people, it sounds familiar. Some people say that Daniel Defoe's Robinson Crusoe is based on it. Others say that Rudyard Kipling's Jungle Book is based on it. And most remarkably, quite a few scholars in the last 20 years have have said that John Locke's theories of human understanding, reason, the individual, experience, and maybe even toleration are derived from it. With Locke, the story goes something like this. The Orientalist Edward Pocock was a professor at Oxford. He and his son, also named Edward Pocock, often went on manuscript expeditions in the Middle East. They got their hands on an Arabic manuscript with this allegory, and they translated it into Latin. Pocock and Locke knew each other. Even though Pocock translated it after Locke wrote his text, the story goes, maybe he told him about it, or maybe he showed him a draft of the translation. So it's all very speculative. Nonetheless, it is interesting that this 12th century allegory traveled to Europe. And it's also interesting that we say that it traveled to Europe, because Spain was already in Europe. It just happened to be Muslim. Here you see three English frontispieces from 1708, 1731, and 1929. The text was translated numerous times, and for many interpreters, it was somewhere between a Rorschach blot and a mirror. Quakers believed that it was about the inner light, empiricists emphasized Hayes' experimentation, rationalists saw the supremacy of reason, and Orientalists saw the limitations of ordinary Muslims. The text became enshrined as a classic in the colonial and post-colonial Middle East in the 19th and 20th centuries. And Arab intellectuals often said that this text is important because it had traveled to Europe. The bigger project is an alternative history of what's called Islamic philosophy, looking at the Middle East and Europe and in the travels of these texts to China, Pakistan, Indonesia, and Israel, looking primarily at editions, prefaces, marginalia, and commentaries, including how this allegory can be used in a children's book as part of an attempt to produce the nation or to imagine different geographies and different grand narratives. Today, it's also a standard text in the global humanities. So, for example, it's taught in Columbia's core curriculum. And this project is ultimately my attempt to think about the politics of the global humanities, how it's produced. Many scholars today claim that Muslim thinkers are important because they anticipated or in some way influenced modern European thought. This trope has an important but neglected precedent. Between 1882 and 1947, Arab scholars attached significance to classical Arabic texts and to their European translations as precursors to modern European thought. For these writers, Ibn Tufayl became the Muslim herald of European modernity. Why did these scholars identify with, of all things, a 12th century text of falsafa or philosophy? And why did they keep repeating the claim that it influenced European development? Modern Arab scholars of the classics, as technicians of tradition, invited readers to retrospectively identify with Hayy ibn Tufayl, to displace cultural pride and anxiety onto the text's history and onto its reception in Europe. What's facilitated by making this book about modern Europe, about an Islamic philosophical heritage, and about how colonized intellectuals engendered or even anticipated their own colonizers' modernity? What projects and what global imaginaries were served in these representations of the text's historical significance? Ibn Tufayl became a figure through whom the colonized claimed superiority and ownership over their colonizers. Editors directed readers to find value in the text precisely as Europe's predecessor, as prefiguring trends in modern European thought, or as having enabled or even caused them. Ibn Tufayl became a kind of ancestral avatar. European thinkers became merely inferior or derivative. Comparisons of Ibn president to fire two European thinkers facilitated two fantasies against their colonizers, a fantasy of cultural superiority and a fantasy of historical eugenics. This, I want to suggest, reinscribed the political dominance of Europe with its teleology of Eurocentric intellectual development. But at the same time, the editors also imagine a different configuration of Arab and global power. They imagine alternative futures and various anti-imperial and post-imperial geographies. The editors' claims about Ibn Tufayl's importance for philosophy are pegged first to their increasing insistence upon the superiority, precedence, or genesis of Europe, and second to the alternative worlds that they imagine beyond Europe. In my remaining time, I'll sketch out the overall argument using three episodes. One of the first popular surveys of Islamic philosophy was published in 1927 by Muhammad Lutfi Juma. Juma was a fairly famous public intellectual. He had translated a number of classics, including Plato's Symposium, Machiavelli's Prince, as well as a few South Asian and East Asian texts. The history of Islam's philosophers combines two impulses. On the one hand, it tries to create an awe-inspiring canon of Islamic thinkers, but it also insists on the value of these thinkers by reference to Europe, either in comparison to European thought or because of its influence on Europe. So, for example, he writes, "This fantasy story is a kind of rational beatitude that many European writers and thinkers imitated and in the footsteps of which they followed." While Jamal does not say who these European thinkers are or how exactly they mimicked Ibn Tufayl, he turns to Robinson Crusoe in order to demonstrate Ibn Tufayl's originality. This book is haunted by Europe from the very start. Jamal begins by addressing the dead Islamic philosophers, calling them forth into the present. "Come forward, wise gentlemen." He invites them out of what he calls the cave of the past, world of silence and quiet, into the present, to strike the Arab masses with the foreignness of their own past. He says, "The majority of the people of this age have not had the honor of knowing who you are. Some will pass by you, surprised at who these ancient philosophers are who lived, contemplated, and explained the universe, who diagnosed events before Kant, Nietzsche, Schopenhauer, etc." These thinkers prefigure European philosophers, but they also make them possible. "It will not occur to the minds of these surprised readers that were it not for you, O dear philosophers, from Al-Kindi to Ibn Rushd, it would not have been possible for any modern European philosopher to have appeared in the world of existence." So here, the importance of this Islamic canon, Al-Kindi to Ibn Rushd, is in reference to Europe, to making Europe possible. Notice how Islam's contribution is thoroughly in the past. But Juma also thinks beyond this. He imaginatively opens up an alternate vision of East-centric world history and intellectual production, one that brackets Europe. He writes a bond of solidarity and resonance between the Eastern Hemisphere's two corners, saying that the Islamic Renaissance during this period reverberated across the East, shaking the corners of the world. So the Persian, Turks, Mongols, and Indians rose up, and even the people of China and of Japan engaged in reform. The Renaissance of Islam was like the tremors of an earthquake. And Jamal concludes, "The two Easts, near and far, were influenced by the Renaissance movements that appeared in either, each having an echo the other." And here he implies an alternate future based on this other past of Islamic philosophy. And what was true for the 9th century is also true for the Renaissance of the 19th in the two Easts, near and far. This vision of two connected Easts perhaps carves out space for pan-Asian world histories and practices. cultural a quiet cultural resonance appears across the continents, where humanistic work in one corner reverberates and echoes and calls forth another renaissance in the other. By imagining the East as this interconnected world, as having a frame already beyond Europe, Jamal seems to take the geography of Orientalism's the Orient and turns it back against Europe. Islam's philosophers become the reservoir of a forgotten past, one that bypasses Europe, extends to the Far East, and calls forth new renaissances without and against European empire. Here he's reimagining both cultural and political power outside and after empire. Reading Ibn Fufayl, in other words, was a way for the colonized to say, we created all colonizers, but also to say, and it doesn't have to be this way. Jumu'ah's inter-Eastern comparisons and these affiliations between corners of the world fall out of the other afterlives of Hayy ibn Qutb. So in 1931 and 1933, we have two articles on Ibn Fufayl. Just as an aside, the second is actually plagiarized from the first largely. But in any case, one article affirms Ibn Tufayl's influence on European philosophy and on fiction as the clearest indication of his influence, while the other presents Ibn Tufayl as more important because he accomplished everything that he did before European storytellers. But the first article, by Ferdinand Telfer, is important for two reasons. It's all about anxieties about the superiority of European scholarship about this text. It's just been studied and translated in European languages. And second, Tautel critiques Ibn Tufayl for his elitism and for his obscurantism. It is, he says, as though Ibn Tufayl withholds, or you could say begrudges, the capacity for understanding spiritual life from the majority of readers. Tautel here sides against Ibn Tufayl and against the main character, Hayy ibn Yaqdhan, with ordinary readers and with the allegory's ordinary islanders. He's refusing the text because he thinks it's not egalitarian. But he also drops his critical engagement to then reaffirm what Europeans say. Ibn Tufayl's is the best Arabic story and the best summary of Arabic philosophy. His plagiarist, 2 years later, leaves out the critique. He just praises Ibn Tufayl's accessible and beautiful text, so we're only left with the monumental, with the awe-inspiring canon. But notice the conflict that's already being set up here. Tautel, on the one hand, wants to say, this is a great text, and we know this in part because it influenced Europe. But at the same time, he wants to say, this text, it is such a problem. It treats people like they're inferior, like they are idiots. This sense that the text is not egalitarian, that it's elitist, that it doesn't respect the reader, that it shouldn't be refused for teaching ordinary citizens because it doesn't have the right lessons, this reaches its apex around 50 years later. So if you recall the children's version that I showed you, it changes the ending. In the actual story, Hayy ibn Yaqdhan meets the islanders. He tries to teach them. He doesn't think they understand. They become annoyed, but they don't say anything. He notices that they seem a little annoyed, so he decides people are irrational animals. In the children's version, Hayy and Adsel go to the island. The people listen to Hayy's story, and then they say, God is great. His power is marvelous. The greatest gift he has given us. There's no conflict, and everyone gets to be exactly like this character, Hayy ibn Yaqdhan, which also means changing the story into one where there is absolutely no politics. This version, by the way, is now available in English as of 2002, and similar work has gone into revising other earlier Arabic and Islamic texts, making them safe for children or safe for the nation. These children's editions, I suspect, would probably form something like a chapter in this particular book. Back to Tautel. He ends his article by saying that he hopes what he's written might pave the way for an edition coming out of the Middle East. His wish would come true 4 years later. The first scholarly Arab-produced edition of Hayy ibn Yaqdhan was published in 1935, and the first Arab monograph devoted to the text in 1946. The editors of the edition are Jamil Saliba and Kamil Ayyad. Jamil Saliba was a Syrian scholar of Arabic historical and philosophical inquiry. He was trained in Paris, and he wrote extensively on Avicenna, education, the history of Arab thought and science, French thought, and he also produced a two-volume Arabic, English, French, Latin philosophical lexicon. His writings reflect his concern with the Arab contribution to world civilization and its place in Arab self-understanding. His co-editor, Kamil Ayyad, wrote on Ibn Khaldun, the historian, and on the history of philosophy, the life of Orientalists, Japan, and social and political issues. He was born in Libya, emigrated during the 1911 Italian invasion, studied in Berlin, and then resided in Damascus. Ahmad Tabluk came from a conservative Muslim family. He's the author of the book of study. He comes from a village just outside of Beirut. He wrote on contemporary politics, the history of Arab thought, pre-Islamic literature, Greek philosophy. Farouk grew up in Beirut. He studied at the American University in Beirut and then in Germany. And he wrote this book while in Beirut, years before he would move to Damascus. These three scholars had a pretty intense, but you might say, a small stakes disagreement about how to read. There was some name-calling, but behind it all, there was also a deeper disagreement about how we should think about power, the future, and the histories of these texts. Here are pictures of Saliba, first as a young man, then as a seasoned scholar. In the 1935 edition, Saliba and Ayyad refused the usual comparisons. They say in their introduction, for example, that saying that there's a relationship of borrowing or one of imitation where Robinson Crusoe would come from Hayy ibn Yaqdhan is utter nonsense. And they go on to say that all comparisons are actually inappropriate. Ibn Tufayl is superior to everything that came after, and so we should not even be comparing in the first place. There is, we can say, no comparison, certainly not to Robinson Crusoe. Meanwhile, in the first monograph devoted to Ibn Tufayl 11 years later by Ahmad Farouk, when Robinson Crusoe appears here in the final chapter, Daniel Defoe is only the sixth European writer whom Farouk claims was deeply influenced by Ibn Tufayl. So if Saliba and Ayyad use contrasts in order to demonstrate originality and superiority, Farouk highlights similarity because he thinks it must always imply influence. So he lists Albertus Magnus, Aquinas, Spinoza, Rousseau, Descartes, Locke, and pretty much the entirety of the Western canon. On Robinson Crusoe specifically, he says, it is unthinkable that Defoe wrote a book that assimilated Hayy ibn Yaqdhan to this degree without knowing it. Before Defoe's death, it had been translated into Latin, English, Dutch, German, and became widely known. Farouk also thinks that Ibn Tufayl made all of European thought and European modernity possible. These are rather grandiose claims. Here, the colonized intellectual claims antecedence and power over the colonizer's intellectual production, as for Hans. So he says, Islamic philosophy controlled the European mind for a few hundred years without interruption, and Ibn Tufayl alone guided European thought, which demonstrates for him Islamic philosophy's relevance for human thought as a whole. When we go back to Saliba and Ayyad, we see that they cast Ibn Tufayl as unique and as superior to all others, but they also approach the allegory as a theory of the natural development of the pure individual stripped of all social influences. Here, Hayy ibn Yaqdhan is a blank slate. The any man or every man, not a prophet, philosopher, superhuman, spontaneously generated on an island and raised by a doe, who he then dissects. The nearby island, similarly, becomes a, quote, human association with traditions and inherited habits, a sociological experiment for the relationship of the individual to society. Notice how these two editors erase Hayy Ibn Yaqban's supernatural superiority, making the allegory applicable to everyone. They erase his elite status and his abnormality. They say, it is unlikely that Ibn Tufayl intended from the first half of the story to say that a single isolated individual can attain what Hayy attained without the aid of a group. Indeed, his aim was to represent human development without needing divine revelation. With this normalization of Hayy, they erase the people whom Ibn Tufayl actually constructs as normal, the islanders. They turn the section about the islanders into Ibn Tufayl's veiled critique of corrupt regime. As for the second half of the story, it is nothing but a concealed social critique. Ibn Tufayl wanted to dissect the social conditions of his age and to expose the corruption of regimes, the decay of morals, and the disappearance of religious principles. But Ibn Tufayl does not say a word about regime corruption, moral decay, or the withdrawal of religion. He consistently says that these islanders, they are pious, honest, and the best among ordinary people, simply limited by their nature. But speaking of veiled critiques, perhaps it is Saliba and Ayyad who are transposing the problems of the modern post-colonial state and its own corrupt regimes onto Ibn Tufayl's context. Perhaps it is their critique that is being veiled. The two things that these scholars found unthinkable and unlikely are, of course, both thinkable and likely. Ibn Tufayl was not the source of various European texts and of modernity, as Farrukh says, and Hayy Ibn Yaqban is not of practical use for the ordinary person, nor is it about the average person. Ibn Tufayl did not produce European modernity, and Hayy is not us. And these scholars said as much to each other. Farrukh mocked Saliba and Ayyad and their analysis, as well as their misspellings of different European scholars' names, and says they are stuck in a different century. But these scholars disagree about context and about which kind of context matters. Saliba and Ayyad had explained the allegory in terms of Ibn Tufayl's life. For them, Hayy is actually standing in for Ibn Tufayl, and the leader of the island, Salaman, is really standing in for the caliph at the time. So they confine their analysis to the author's context and the life of the author. And here, it's a very happy context in the way that they present it. Farrukh, meanwhile, describes Ibn Tufayl's age as one of absolute anarchy, very unhappy. And for him, philosophy flourished in spite of all of this. This kind of intellectual production, he says, it helps combat social and political anarchy, and maybe it can do these things again in his age. The two editors and Farrukh read Ibn Tufayl's context, in other words, as their own, and so depending on how they read their own present, they saw Ibn Tufayl very differently, and depending on how they read Ibn Tufayl, that showed them different things about their present. Farrukh himself offers a unconventionally broad context for studying a text. He discusses North Africa, but then goes on to the Crusades, the papal struggles, the Norman conquest of Sicily, the situation of the Byzantine Empire, until he gets to the modern colonization of the Middle East. So he situates Ibn Tufayl in these grand world historical hubs that shape the geopolitics of his present. And in a different text, he also challenges readers to understand all of history as a world historical battle between Europe and Afro-Asia, West and East, where the Middle East is a battle. When Saliba read this, he was not very happy, or perhaps he wasn't very happy about what Sadduk said about this book. So he takes on the tones of scandalized disciplinary authority in a book review of Sadduk's monographs, where he says Sadduk makes all sorts of unqualified proclamations, he fails to adhere to even the basics of the historical method, and instead of focusing on the life of the author and events that directly impacted someone's philosophy, the book is really about irrelevant events and tangents with no relationship to any of this. But this disagreement was not only methodological. Saliba thought that the problem was corrupt regimes and moral decay and the singularity of the Islamic philosophy. He doesn't say a word about European imperialism. Farrukh thought it's all about European empire. So the different approaches were about why one studies the past, whose past it is, and its relationship to different possible imagined futures. So I'd like to wrap up by raising three things. My contention is that by looking at how a text was canonized and how people read it, we get a fuller picture into the insides of a discipline. We get a richer, moving image into how the editors, translators, and scholars understood the world. We get why this is a text that today continues to be read. I focused on how it was read in the Middle East and how we should look at editors and translators as political thinkers in their own right. They're the ones who create traditions. They're the ones who invent the narratives about which texts matter and what they mean to us today. And eventually, I'd like to explore how was translated into other languages, and how today it's being canonized as Islamic philosophy all over the world. The second thing I want to mention is that this kind of afterlife of the text helps us critically historicize, critically trace the terms upon which we read texts. It helps us see the politics behind the comparisons that might appear to us natural or obvious. When we compare Ibn Tufayl to Locke or to Robinson Crusoe or whoever else, are we doing this in order to generalize Locke's language and to make it seem universal, or are we making Locke seem to follow Islamic thought? Why? Are we talking about the medieval Muslim in order to not talk about the contemporary Muslim, or do we talk about the medieval in order to say something about the modern? Finally, when we read these texts afterwards, we can start to think about other ways of thinking about political order. Jomar's geography turns east to imagine the near and far being connected. Helke's criticism of Ibn Tufayl demands equality and respect. Saliba and Ayyad regard present-day corruption, and Farrukh rereads knowledge through world historical power politics. These moments invite us to approach these sources and histories for their critiques of the present and its normative ideals, and for their reimaginings of its formations and entanglements. These texts invite us to read the texts that are themselves about them in order to reimagine the past, but also to imagine different worlds and different futures. Thank you. Happy to take any questions, comments, thoughts, ideas. Sure. Yes. No, for sure. So, part of what's interesting about this text by Ibn Tufayl, I had mentioned that Ibn Tufayl really wasn't all that important during his life. And you could even say that the history of Islamic philosophy, he wasn't all that important until the text was translated into European languages. That is, I think, true. There are some responses to him, but they're not major. He was not, for example, Avicenna. He is not, for example, Isfarabi, thinkers that shaped the entirety of Islamic and then afterward medieval European thought through the translation movement. So part of what's distinctive, I think, about Ibn Tufayl is how we have a text that's actually quite fascinating in its own way, but that only became now part of the reading list on, for example, comprehensive exams or for undergraduates at Columbia and McCall, because of this rather peculiar history. And in the process of reading it, part of the question is, do we need to pay attention to this history? My contention is yes, but I could imagine people making the other argument, saying, just read the text for what it is, who cares why it's important to them. We can sort of go beyond this history. Exactly. So part of it for me is that there's a way of reading the text, and I think a lot of scholars who work on this text today pursue this line of inquiry, where they say, where did Ibn Tufayl get these particular sets of ideas? What's the relationship, for example, of Hayy ibn Yaqdan being spontaneously generated to Adam, or being the ark to Moses, right? Which are pretty clear allusions there. So that certainly is part of what's happening today. But when we look, for example, at 1929, it was one of the British editions by Fulton, I believe. He was the keeper of manuscripts at the Bodleian at that time. So he begins by saying Ibn Tufayl was writing in an age where the caliph was oppressing the ordinary folks, so Ibn Tufayl had to write his allegory. He had to write it as an allegory. He couldn't come out and actually say what he meant. So notice a very different understanding of the context. But also, Fulton says the ordinary islanders were going to kill Hayy ibn Yaqdan. They were so annoyed that they were going to kill him. And yet, there's no evidence of that in the text. Right? So this is where the Rorschach blot really is quite accurate. You think about how people project their desires, they project their fears, they project their hopes about the future onto an allegory about a boy on an island who is raised by a duck. There's something really quite bizarre about it. Part of what, so there's a strand in Islamic philosophy that this text would fit into from this period that emphasizes the relationship between master and disciple, and that it's really only master and disciple who are able to attain knowledge of true religion beyond the kind of mere symbols that are presented to us ordinary people. So Ibn Tufayl is clearly playing on that aspect of it, which would then be a very strange thing to say today when we actually believe that people are equal, right? That people are actually, in some sense, that they all have the same sets of faculties and are therefore able to understand the truth. So it's also, in this sense, a very untimely thing. So it's elevation to something that represents the best of a tradition. You need to do some serious bias in order to make it do that. So it's illustrative of the Islamic philosophy and its relationship to Neoplatonism. Right? So if you think about Plato's Republic, where you have the allegory of the cave, that most of us are just chained in the cave, right, looking at shadows, and only the true philosopher is able to understand the truth. In Islamic philosophy, this becomes the prophet. Right? The prophet-like figure is actually a philosopher who has been able, through revelation, to bypass all the different levels that we actually need to go to and just immediately get the truth. Hayyim then does precisely that. He's able to just on his own understand the nature of thought. And the way that Islamic philosophy seemed to operate, you would basically have the same question that animated Christian philosophy and that animated Jewish philosophy. How do we harmonize religion and philosophy? How do we harmonize faith and reason? And Ibn Tufayl's answer is, well, you got reason for the elite, the philosopher, prophet type figure, and then faith for everyone else. And everyone else is damned, whereas the philosopher, prophet type figure is not. And there were different answers. Right? So you can think about how Ibn Rushd tries to say, no, no, actually these two things are along the same lines, and we shouldn't be approaching them as in this particular topic. They have a different relationship to each other. You can think about Aquinas as having given us also a different answer, Maimonides a different one, or Al-Ghazali, who flips all this on its head and says, actually, faith is what trumps reason. You can't have, you need to have some kind of faith in reason itself, so therefore the basis is wrong. So that's part of the constellation of that debate. And that a lot of that just gets lost in all of the attempts to make the text speak to the present or through these projections. Yes, no, the way that Ibn Tufayl narrates it, then I'll tell you what I think he's up to. So the way that he narrates it is, Ibn Affan had never seen another person, he'd never seen anything die before. And he goes to his mother, Jo, she's no longer moving, he starts pushing at her, nothing happens, he thinks she must be hurt. So he wants to figure out what's hurting her. So he takes a sharp object and opens her up, and then starts looking through, then he notices that something must have been there, and now it's gone. That must be the soul. During this time, often, because dissections were frowned upon in Islamic science, dissecting humans in particular is dumb. So, part of what Ibn Tufayl might be signaling is he's dissecting an animal, and that's okay in order to. I prefer to read it as this kind of trauma, because who in the right mind would be but Ibn Tufayl here is also signaling to us the state of science during this time, where it was believed that the soul does actually reside inside the heart, and that there's some, I believe it's some gray, smoky matter that's supposed to be inside it. So its absence in that sense is, I guess it's cutting it, So that's actually the hard question, because I'm a Muslim, because on the one hand, it is true that the text had been available to the Muslims. We have no evidence that Defoe saw it. He doesn't mention it at any point. It's not in any of his correspondences. So we're speculating whether he saw it or not. It's also possible, for some people have said, keep in mind, during this time, there were so many shipwrecks taking place that were being reported on regularly in various European circles. So it's possible that that's what influenced it. But then, as Farouk says, that really, it's a god, it's the main character, and you have a side character on an island. What are the chances that you would have this kind of similarity? I think until we find some key crucial evidence to really say that there is a direct relationship here, part of the task is to shift the focus and to ask, why are we invested in there being this kind of connection, in this kind of relationship? I mean, I myself find that pretty exciting. Based on this, other people have argued that I've been reading this story from my daughter pretty much every day on that island. But I like it, but I can only read it so many times. Some people have argued that where the wild things are might also be in some way informed by this. Right? You have someone who travels to this other place, but there's monsters rather than people. Part of it might also be that this is one of those texts that it has so much thrown inside it, so many different symbols. And two to three islands, you have animals, no predators, that can this all be coincidence? Yes, no, I think that that's right. We could say that, we could, and maybe this is what Ibn Tufayl intended to do, that we can either find the origin of this kind of story in theology, in religious histories, where there are many examples of this, or we can find it in philosophy, in Plato, in the philosopher who exits the cave, discovers the truth far away, and then comes back. We don't know that he actually succeeds in freeing. Right? So in that sense, perhaps Ibn Tufayl is actually saying, just as there is this question about harmonizing faith and reason, I will give you a story that you can read, either in terms of the history of religion or in terms of the history of philosophy. And that, that in that sense, there's something actually quite productive, rich, but also dizzy. There's a kind of vertigo in the story and trying to locate all the different resonances. there are. Tradition. Others are within the Islamic philosophical tradition. And most of these stories are less the allegories are pretty straightforward. So you have one response to this text is called rather than the self-taught philosopher, as this one sometimes translated, it's the self-taught theologian, where you have this character who, on his own, not through reason, but rather through faith, ends up discovering the truth about God, but also its limits. That's by Ibn Aziz. Meanwhile, in the other texts that are based on this, similarly, have attempts to think through the relationship of society and person, between the afterlife and life, reason and revelation. But those texts seem to, they don't seem to have then been translated quite in the way that this. Where this really does seem to be primarily a question of cultural power. It seems to have this real cachet to it. But in that, to answer the question, yes, there are these other texts that are directly in response to this, mostly in Judeo-Arabic. Yes. There's one other text I can think of, early Spanish text from, the early 1500s, I think, that is supposed to have been, or that people think was probably based on Ayyubin and Yaqdan. And that one actually follows it very closely. It reads almost like potentially a translation of a cultural commentary. So it's interesting, right, because what you're making me also think of is how the idea of the single text kind of falls apart the moment that we start thinking about these earlier periods and these manuscripts and these commentaries and borrowings, some borrowings, because rather than writing, for example, here is Ibn Yaqdan in the 20th century, and here are like the different editions, instead we have to think about these like a tree, right, with all sorts of different branches and roots growing out and trying to figure out what's the relationship of this one to this other one. I think that's part of what's exciting about this kind of thing. Yeah. Perhaps, so the, there are at this point around, I think I've seen six or seven different translations into English. When it was first translated by Popov into Latin, in the introduction he says, this is, the reason that this text is important is less for the story, more for the introduction in the beginning, where Ibn Tufayl says, so here's basically my literature review. Here are the different people who have argued this about reason, those who have argued that about revelation, and here's where I'm going to come down on that particular question. So in terms of it being accessible, starting in the first translation, 1707, I think, early 1700s was the first one. since then.